Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. Question number one has been withdrawn, and at question number two, I call Claire Hawhey.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work that it is doing to support those affected by forced historic adoption.
Minister Natalie Dawn Innes.
Well, I'd like to start by saying how sorry I am for the profound pain, loss and lifelong impact that historic forced adoption had on people's lives, and I extend my deepest sympathies to everyone affected. Most recently, we held 5 lived experience sessions with mothers and adoptees and are taking forward actions based on what we heard. We continue to fund the charity Health in Mind to offer specialist peer support to those affected by historic adoption. And we're also funding Birthlink to manage the Adoption Contact Register for Scotland, which helps support connections between families affected by adoption.
Claire Hawhey.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Since the first year anniversary of the former First Minister delivering a formal apology to those impacted by historical adoption practices, I've been in contact with some campaigners who have shared subsequent concerns, which I know the Minister is aware of, having met them in June. The apology in itself isn't the end point for those impacted. And so can I ask the Minister what is being done and what more can be done to ensure the voices of lived experience are at the heart of the post-apology work that is currently being undertaken by the Scottish Government?
Minister.
So, as I mentioned previously, we've held those 5 lived experience sessions with mothers and adoptees, and I'd really like to thank everyone who participated for sharing their views on such a sensitive subject. In response to what people told us about the importance of better information and awareness raising, as a first step, we're developing dedicated historic forced adoption pages on mygov.scot. And this is so all the information about post-adoption services and help can be found in one place. We're also developing commemorative copies of the National Apology, which will be available very shortly. And this is in direct response to asks from the affected groups. We're committed to continuing our engagement with people with lived experience to continue to inform our approach. Something that we heard directly from people involved was the importance of being clear about what is realistically achievable. So going forward, we will propose to have targeted engagement on specific key policy proposals.
Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Great work has been done by the movement for an adoption apology group, and it was a welcome development to see victims receive a formal apology from the Scottish Government. My constituency, expresses concern that given the passage of time, the truth about the experiences of those impacted will be lost. Has the Scottish Government given any consideration to working with mothers to enable their oral histories to be recorded and archived?
Minister.
I understand the member and her constituents' concerns. I would be more than happy to consider ways to raise awareness of mothers' experiences of historic forced adoption and the lifelong impacts they've endured, whether that's through oral histories or by any other means. I'd be open to discussing any proposals the member has in relation to this, further to a recent letter to the First Minister.
Thank you. Question number 3, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and what issues were discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, President Officer. Both ministers and Scottish Government officials regularly meet with representatives of all health boards, including NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, to discuss importance to patients and services being provided.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. This week, Unison reps at the Royal Alexandra Hospital came to me with serious concerns about the possible closure of Ward 36, which has 22 beds for older people with complex needs. There appears to be no thought-through plan for the ward, the staff or the patients. 1,000 signatures have already been gathered on a petition opposing this move, which one can only assume is a result of budget cuts. Has the Cabinet Secretary been made aware of this proposal to close this ward and cut 22 beds from the REH? Does he agree with me that the move should not go ahead, given the concerns raised by the NHS staff that work there? And given the Chancellor's statement yesterday, which not only increases bed numbers in England, but gives the Scottish Government an extra £3.4 billion, will he ensure that resources are made available to the Health Board to protect these vital local services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Neil Bibby for raising this point. To answer directly his question, no, that, that proposal has not been brought to me. It's obviously a local decision to be taken. Obviously, I respect those local proposals and the local decision-making regarding that, but I also respect what Mr Bibby has raised with me in terms of the concern that has been raised around staff and by the trade unions, and I would expect Greater Glasgow and Clyde, if they're taking forward such a proposal, to be consulting, and there are very clear consultation pathways and expectations that government puts on boards when they're looking at service redesign. I don't have the full picture because this is the first that I have heard of it, but I would obviously be looking into this further myself, and I'd be making sure that I'm contacting both Mr Bibby and other local representatives on the matter.
Question number four, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether the funding for the £12.5 million provided for education in Malawi, Rwanda and Zambia was set out in the 2024-25 Scottish Budget.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thanks, Sue Webber, for her question. Supporting international development remains one of the most important ways that Scotland can be a good global citizen. And I confirm that these programmes are supported by the International Development Fund of £11.5 million in 2024-25, as published on the 19th of December 2023 and approved by Parliament in March. The budget for year one of our inclusive education programmes from Malawi, Zambia and Rwanda, announced on the 15th of October, amounts to £1.65 million in 2024-25. And over 5 years, subject to the usual parliamentary approvals in relation to the Annual Budget Act, we expect the total value of the programme to be £12.5 million.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. In Scotland, classroom standards are plummeting and violence is rising. Teacher numbers are declining, secure full-time posts are scarce, and cuts to school hours and assistant numbers are at risk. Currie Community High School Parent Council are writing to Edinburgh Council to express their deep concerns regarding the proposed cuts to additional support needs services within our education community. They state that these cuts could significantly affect the quality of education and support for those students who rely on ASN services and wider learners. Foreign aid is reserved, and public cash should be spent at home rather than abroad. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the Scottish Government should be prioritising the education of Scotland's young people first?
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland's international development programme is now entering its 20th year and has, until now, it would appear, had cross-party support. Spending on international development on inclusive education is minuscule when compared to spending on education in Scotland. Hopefully Sue Webber will reflect, as indeed will her colleagues behind her who are nodding, on the intervention that's just been made, and support the modest but impactful way in which Scotland demonstrates its commitment to being a good global citizen.
Question number five, Elena Whittam.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work that it has been undertaken with disabled people's organisations regarding the delivery of its Disability Equality Plan.
Minister Kocab-Stewart.
Thank you. We remain committed to addressing the significant challenges disabled people are facing following decades of austerity and a cost of living crisis. This year, we committed £6.1 billion on benefits, including an additional £300 million for adult disability payment. That represents an investment of over £1.1 billion over and above what we receive from the UK Government. But it is clear that disabled people continue to face significant barriers, and that is why we committed to delivering the Disability Equality Plan, which lays the foundations for meaningful change. The limitations of our devolved budget mean that it's not always possible to meet the full extent of everyone's ambitions in this first phase. However, we will continue to work with disabled people's organisations to build towards a fairer Scotland.
Elena Whittam.
I thank the Minister for her answer. Disabled people's organisations, including Disability Equality Scotland, Glasgow Disability Alliance and Inclusion Scotland, have been in contact with evidence that underlines how disabled people have been disproportionately impacted by the cost of living crisis across the UK. Can the Minister speak to the existing support that households in Scotland are able to access this winter? And will she outline what further work has been done alongside DPOs to ensure that disabled people are not left behind in the Scottish Government's mission to end poverty in Scotland in light of the Disabled People Demand Justice campaign?
Minister.
Thank you. I can give her that assurance. We introduced the pension age disability payment worth between £290 and £434 a month to people of state pension age and over who are disabled. The child winter heating payment will help households with severely disabled children manage the additional costs they face this winter. We have secured the agreement of energy suppliers, consumer organisations and DPOs to co-design a social tariff mechanism to evidence its viability. We also reopened the Independent Living Fund, helping up to 1,000 more disabled people to access the support that they need.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Presiding Officer, this week, almost exactly 1 year on from telling me that my bill to support transitions for disabled people wasn't needed, and a whole 8 years after the SNP first promised it, the Government delayed the transitions to adulthood strategy, affecting a number of young disabled people. They said they'd done this to allow sufficient time to support meaningful engagement, but blaming people who need this strategy for this Government's delay is a new low. So can I ask the Minister, how many more years will young disabled people have to wait until this Government gets their act together?
Minister.
I understand the frustrations that the member is expressing, and I commend the work that she did on that, and I would give her reassurance that we are not delaying. I have already outlined some of the tasks that we are taking forward and the investment, and we will continue to progress that work.
Question number six, Alexander Burnett.
To ask the Scottish Government when the Health Secretary last met the Scottish Ambulance Service to discuss rural ambulance provision.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I met with the Chair of the Scottish Ambulance Service on the 5th of June 2024, where rural ambulance provision across Scotland was discussed. In addition, my officials meet with Scottish Ambulance Service management regularly to discuss a range of topics, including ambulance provision across the country, and we receive weekly performance reports, which are scrutinised and reported on accordingly.
Alexander Burnett.
Earlier this month, a family in Torfinns had a terrifyingly long wait for an ambulance during labour after a call was answered by someone in Yorkshire who couldn't locate their rural address. As reported in the Sunday Post, the father and grandmother had to be talked through delivering the baby and then had to perform CPR on the newborn baby for half an hour before a vehicle arrived. Thankfully, both mother and baby are healthy, but this is a completely horrifying experience that no family should have to endure. In Aberdeenshire, journeys to the ARI can take up to 2 hours, not including waiting for an ambulance to arrive. So does the Cabinet Secretary think this is acceptable? And what support will be provided to ensure that rural communities have an ambulance service that meets their needs?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm aware of the media reports, and obviously my apologies to the family in that case. I cannot understand, as a father, the difficulty that that family would have felt, and the challenge of going through that of that process. I recognise that. I understand it. I've recently corresponded with Alexander Burnett in terms of the ambulance provision within his area, and I'd be more than happy to meet with him to discuss both this case and indeed ambulance provision in his area in general.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. In recent months, I've been approached by a number of constituents highlighting examples of what appear to be unnecessary delays in tasking ambulances in Orkney. I'm due to meet the Chief Executive of the Ambulance Service next month to discuss the issue. But would the Health Secretary support steps to adopt a more tailored approach in island communities to reduce delays in ambulance call-outs wherever possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I know from visits to Orkney and indeed to the Western Isles and previously to Shetland that there is work underway to try to take the approach that Liam MacArthur is setting out. And there is innovative work being done in island communities where there obviously has to be an adaptation to the demography as well as the geography that they're dealing with to ensure that we are resourcing both ambulance services but also primary care and urgent care need. I'd be more than happy to discuss that further with Mr MacArthur after he's had that discussion with the ambulance service.
Claire Hawhey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The ambulance service is a vital component of emergency care throughout the year, but particularly in the colder months. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline the efforts the Scottish Ambulance Service is making to prepare for this period, including in rural areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. Claire Hawkey is absolutely right. The work of the ambulance service is critical, and I thank them for the work that they do, alongside my thanks to all health and social care staff at this time of year. In particular, the Scottish Ambulance Service will play a critical role in delivery of various aspects of health care throughout winter, with their key focus being maintaining a fast and effective response to those in need of emergency care and support. The Scottish Ambulance Service management team have been engaging with chief executives and chairs of all health boards across Scotland ahead of winter to plan at a more local level, including developing plans for urgent care in rural and island communities.
Question number 7, Liam Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on Police Scotland's extension across Scotland of the North East pilot of not investigating low-level crime.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, all incidents reported to Police Scotland are individually assessed on the basis of threat, harm and risk, investigative opportunity and vulnerability. To suggest otherwise is incorrect. Where there is no threat, harm or risk and no lines of inquiry, officers will issue the caller with a crime report number and file the incident with scope to return to it should investigative opportunities emerge. Police Scotland confirmed to the SPA in June that the proportionate response to crime approach has been adopted across all divisions as of 24th of June. This, of course, is an operational decision for the service, similar to many forces in England, and the SPA will receive an evaluation report in December.
Liam Kerr.
Well, the people of the North East have to live through this experiment, and alongside reports of the 16-year-old who, after drinking alcohol on the streets of Elgin, killed RAF veteran Keith Rawlinson after being refused admission onto his coach, we hear reports of Inveruree residents being intimidated by gangs of teens using the town centre as a personal playground, and Old Meldrum, Balmeddy, Pitmedden residents reporting use brandishing knives at passers-by. Does the Cabinet Secretary concede that electing not to investigate certain crimes, coupled with officer reductions and budget cuts, creates a haven for more antisocial behaviour issues across our communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, could I draw Mr Kerr's attention to the comments and contribution of the Assistant Chief Constable Boyd, who said that the response, the impact of this proportionate response to lower level offences gives officers more time to focus on local policing, keeping people safe from harm, protecting the vulnerable, bringing criminals to justice, solving problems and reducing re-offending. And also the impact of the North East pilot saw public satisfaction rates increase and freed up 2,657 police officers, all to the good effect of communities in the North East.
Thank you. Question number 8, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on how many genders there are.
Minister Kocab-Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's position is that of the law. In law, people are either male or female.
Rachel Hamilton.
I'm pleased to hear that Kocab-Stewart agrees with the First Minister that there are two genders. But in official guidance published this month, the SNP government claimed that there are dozens of different genders. Dozens. This doesn't make sense to people in mainstream Scotland. It seems ridiculous for this to be the focus of the Scottish government. Why is the Scottish government wasting so much time and resource on fringe obsessions?
Yes.
Minister. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government did not claim that. The Scottish Government recently updated its guidance for public bodies on collecting data on sex and gender to include a coding framework for free text responses. The framework is there to help official statistic producers to categorise people who identify as trans and have completed an open response question about their trans status. The categories were developed based on the most common responses to the question in the Census 2022. The framework should not be interpreted to mean there are a particular number of genders. It should only be used as a guide to classify responses to the recommended trans status question in surveys.
Thank you. That concludes general questions.